Our scene opens on our heroes. They are the worse for wear after the harrowing events of last session. On the road to Valaki to find a wedding dress for the Mad Abbot, the group met Count Strahd von Zarovic. To the group's horror, he had Roland's spellbook in hand. The Wan Nabob offered the spellbook up in exchange for information of Irina's whereabouts. The group attempted to whip the book from his grasp, which earned little more than the Dread Count's ire. After a short losing battle, Aragorn gave up the location of his prize in order to stay Strahd's hand. Strahd quickly jettisoned the spellbook and made haste for the village of Kresk, where Marcus was keeping Irina safe. Without the help of his allies, Marcus had but no choice than to allow the devil to take Irina by force, vowing to help her escape the clutches of Strahd at a later time. The party did their best to prevent the black carriage from bearing her to Ravenloft, but to no avail. What will they do now? Okay. So you guys are at Kresk, hanging out, kind of around the gates there. So what are you going to do?
Yeah, didn't we already engage with Strahd?
Yeah, you did.
Yeah, and he fled.
Mm-hmm.
Well, he didn't really flee. He got what he wanted, so he just left.
Yeah.
Just howl around the lake.
All right, so family group talk here. Strahd said that he would invite us to the wedding. Considering exactly who we're dealing with, I do not doubt that he will.
Well, perhaps the cake will be good.
I seriously doubt that Strahd is capable of producing a cake palatable to human lips. Tongues, rather.
I'm sure he has cooks.
He will just outsource it. It'll be good.
Alright, so we are. I suppose then we can look forward to a decent cake. But other than that, this is a very dire situation.
We lost whatever you said there, Meridian. Oh, I guess I did.
Pocket some kind of sword, I think.
Sorry, I just disconnected briefly. Do you guys say anything? Have any questions?
We're just talking amongst ourselves.
Okay.
Truth be told, with what just happened, I'm not sure I exactly see the point in pursuing all of these smaller goals.
Well, the point would be to avoid a very painful death. That is the point.
Would that not mean simply waiting here?
I mean, if we waited here long enough, we'd probably still die a painful death.
It'll be slow. It might be in your sleep, which is the best kind. So about what makes you think that this sword can kill Lord Strahd?
That was my question as well.
Get this fancy?
We never. I definitely never mentioned that to Aragorn.
Somebody did.
Yeah, somebody definitely said something about it.
In character?
Yep.
Oh no, out of character, this is all... Oh man, this is really obnoxious without John.
Yeah.
Well, I think that we should go track down these various sources of power, or whatever it was Marcus was talking about. And use those to rescue this damsel in distress.
I can play as
Marcus.
Put
our swords to this man's heart.
Unless somebody else wants to be Marcus, I'll be Marcus.
In mid-sentence, I was.
Sorry.
We still have time. We can get ready and destroy him before the ceremony.
Yeah, Marcus says, weddings, they take a long time to plan. prepare. You need flowers. You need all this stuff. We probably have some time at the very least.
Yeah. We should work to get each other's more combat skills and get ready with some, I don't know, stuff.
So what, D&D montage?
Marcus says...
You all said there was some kind of druid gems or something. I don't know, I wasn't here.
Yeah. Marcus says, well, the way I see it, we have a couple places we can go and work on. We could go to Valaki and get the wedding dress, or we could go to that place that has the other gem, Berez, I think it was called. It was the ruins down to the south. Or we can try to chase down whatever these fortunes say.
Fortunes?
Yeah.
He says, yes, of course. I can't believe I didn't tell you, Elena. We had a fortune teller read us our fortunes for this terrible place.
Oh, all right, then. Always trust a fortune teller. That's my motto.
She seemed pretty legit. She knew things about me that, and about all of us, in fact, that no one else could have known.
Like that Roland used to wet the bed when he was 11.
Well, like Roland was saying.
That's odd. That's odd that you would think that, considering the fact that you left home when I was 7.
That's besides the point.
Well, she didn't say that you started at 11.
I just assumed it kept going till then.
I don't understand what the differences there are, Regal.
I just assumed you kept going, kept doing it until you were 11.
Anyway,
I think something so stupid. Regardless,
our fortunes. We still have the four fortunes that are unanswered. The beggar was the holy sword for dark needs by an elf. I think that we have that one already figured out. We also had there's a holy symbol on a throne somewhere, and
not specific.
Yeah, well, it seems like that'd probably be somewhere in Castle Ravenloft. I'd imagine that would be the only place where a throne would be.
I'm not sure. So sure we should head over there.
Yeah, maybe we table that one, and then the ant. There was also bones everywhere, gives you the knowledge of the ancient. That's a little bit hard to figure that one out. Maybe, who knows? That we'll put a pin in that one as well.
Cemeteries, graveyards, piles of bones.
Yeah.
Trouble is that those are very, very common in this neck of the woods.
That's true.
Like a design choice.
But then there was one about a broken wizard, and I think that could be anywhere.
A wizard's mind is broken, but his power is not.
Right, and he's going to be our ally to bringing down Strahd. I think he would be powerful. Maybe he might be something that we can get to before we enter Ravenloft.
Yeah, let's get to ready and beat his ass up.
Hey, so is the wedding dress ploy is that even on the table anymore?
There's still those are our three options.
I'm not sure if the abbot likely realizes that this that or knows at this point that Irene has been kidnapped and Strahd intends to marry her. So I'm not exactly sure if giving him the wedding dress is going to if he is going to accept the wedding dress is what I mean.
Well, if he's as angelic as he says he is, he'll honor any deal that he's already made.
Mad though he may be, that is probably correct.
I think we should go for the druid crystals or whatever they are. Those sound enticing.
Enticing, yes, and we are good friends. Oh wait, Brack, that was my mistake. I kept calling them druids, but they're not. They're were-ravens, right?
The Martikovs, yes.
Yeah, I would like to spend a bit. If we had the time, I would like to dig deeper into my study of them. I feel as though using them to grow grapes for wine, worthy cause though it may be, is likely deeply underutilizing such a source of magical power.
Oh, were we intending to give them to someone else? I didn't know that.
Yes.
Wanted them for ourselves.
Why would we take them for ourselves? They were stolen from friends of ours.
My friends.
Marcus but says, friends. The Martikovs are the only people in this terrible land who have helped us along.
No, I'm sure they'll be willing to let us borrow their crystals to save a young girl's life if they're so nice.
Well, of course. That said, they're in. On top of studying them for myself, the Martikovs likely know more about them. That likely know something, some useful information about them. That said, getting this wedding dress, returning it to the abbot, and seeing Grar restored is probably number one on my list of priorities right now.
Aragal, what do you think?
Oh, is there a way to bring Grar back? I didn't know.
Yes. Your dear grandfather.
He said BRB.
Oh. I imagine he would agree.
The abbot, who as it turns out is a deva, not exactly the...
Stereotypical.
Not exactly the angelic figure that I personally expected, but he claims that if we bring him a wedding dress, a proper wedding dress, with which he can clothe his patchwork bride for Strahd, he can bring Grar back from the dead, fully restored, rather than some sort of horrific zombie monster. Hopefully. Maybe. Okay, now that I say all that aloud, it sounds as though this isn't the smartest course of action, but...
The love of our grandpa.
Anything for family.
Yay! Let's go.
Okay.
Well, that's just me, though.
Well, whatever we do, we need to do it fast.
Yeah, it's better than sitting out here. Let's go down the road and see as it comes.
Okay. All right. It's settled then.
All right. So remember, me.
But first, wait. Sorry.
I was just about to say, Elena, Audrey, and I are all banished from. From Valaki, so we have to keep that in mind.
On the down low.
Whoever let a little banishment stop them.
Not you guys, that's for damn sure. Okay. Let's put you on the map.
I had Disguise Self, but it's in my second spellbook.
What second spellbook? Oh, the ritual one?
My backup spellbook.
Oh, you got backups on backups. I guess you have to. It's the most important thing. Okay. All right, so you guys are over here at Kresk. And Marcus is coming with you, since there's nothing there for him to guard.
Hey, Marcus.
Yes.
Can I hold on to that magical sword?
No, absolutely not.
Damn it.
Okay. So let's see. So you guys are going to head to Velaki then. All right. So I need Elena and Roland to give me some rolls on the for a random encounter.
What's the number again?
D20, yeah.
Just one.
Okay.
Just one second, sister.
Okay. Good. So you guys make it to the Raven River Crossroads, which I've read that thing dozens of times. I'm not going to read it again. You do see a tower. What's that?
Is it the one with the sign?
Yeah.
That Tarkin fixed?
Somebody fixed it. You guys have fixed so many damn signs. You do see Lake Baratok to your, the north, and you see a little tower over there, which is kind of cool.
What's in the tower?
Well, you don't know. You've never been there.
How far away is it from where we are?
Take you about an hour and a half out of your way.
Who wants to check out this tower for no good reason? I do, but
not that spooky windmill, is it?
No, it's not the spooky windmill.
No, that's way further up north, northeast.
Yeah.
Oh no. I mean, I'm of course curious myself, but maybe we should ask one of the locals exactly what the story is here before we try to enter it.
Aragol is a local. Does he know anything about it?
No, that's right.
Aragol, yeah. So, give me a history check, Aragol.
Lena just sort of like nudges Roland and says, "What's your sense of adventure? This is what happens when you read books all the time."
Fine.
I feel
okay.
I had a stronger sense of adventure before arriving here.
Yeah, Aragol, you just know that that tower has been there as long as you can remember, and you think it used to belong to a wizard or something.
Oh, shit.
Wait, what?
Wizard. Sorry, in character. Oh, yeah, like in the fortune. We should go there.
Yeah, we should go investigate. He could help us.
Okay.
Maybe to get into the town or something.
Well, I, of course, am always...
Wizard I've heard since we got.
Well, I, of course, am always obligated to explore sources of magical power.
Okay.
Yeah, we still have to figure out how to get into the city. So,
obligated is the wrong word. Obliged. Yeah, that's it.
Yeah. You could be obligated. I don't know what your flaw is. All right. Let's do that. All right, so you guys cruise along. Give me Audrey and Grar need to give, or Aragol need to both give me a random encounter thing. D20, please.
I have 10.
10? Not good
and
enough.
Five.
And 5. Okay, you guys get there successfully. Okay.
Well, you said all right. Not good enough right after we roll so that we don't encounter anything.
Yeah, you don't encounter anything. Boring.
Not good enough for him to kill us.
Yeah. Okay. All right. So you approach this tower. You come to a cold mountain lake, which is the Lake Baratok there, enclosed by misty woods and rocky bluffs. Thick fog creeps across the dark, still waters. The trail ends at a grass-covered causeway that stretches 100 yards across the lake to a flat, marshy island with a stone tower on it. The tower is old and decrepit, with collapsing scaffolds clinging to one side where a large gash has split the wall. Time-worn griffin statues, their wings and flanks covered with moss, perch atop buttresses that support the walls. Parked near the base of the tower within sight of the entrance is a barrel-topped wagon splattered with mud.
What?
Splattered with what?
Mud.
Oh, thank God.
Not blood. Mud.
I thought you were about to say something else entirely.
Poop.
Poop.
Splattered with grar.
Oh, yeah. That'd be gross, too.
It's a poop wizard.
Ugh. That was the second least popular school of magic. I won't tell you what the least popular one is.
Wow.
That was actually very, very good role playing by Audrey.
When I grow up, I want to be a wizard.
Yeah, you'll be something. All right, so what are you guys going to do?
I'm sure you'll get there someday.
All right. I'm going to cast Detect Magic as a ritual and see if there's any residual enchantments in the surrounding area.
Yeah, so you cast it. I guess you kind of get a little bit closer enough to cast the Detect Magic in that area. The thing that you notice mostly is that there's some kind of magical ward on this tower in general, which is, the effect is essentially identical to an anti-magic field. And it's centered on the tower and extends, you're getting signatures of it extending about 5 feet away from it in all directions. You feel like any magic that goes there is just instantly drained of its potency.
This doesn't seem like the sort of enchantment that a wizard's tower would be warded by.
You don't know if there's maybe some way to get around that for certain people, but you don't think that your spells will work there.
Right. Unless,
finally, it's my time to shine.
Unless, of course, someone on the outside cast it to keep something in. I stroke my chin.
Who knows?
Among my people, there is legend that if you swim in a Lake Baratok, it will counteract this strange field.
Did you say field?
Yes, field.
Elena just kind of walks into and out of the field repeatedly. It's like, hey, look what I can do. Roland.
Okay. As you go across the threshold of where that anti-magic field kind of comes down, so the hair on your back of your neck kind of stands up on end, like static electricity.
Hey, Roland, look, I'm equally useful on either side of this field.
Excellent.
Just taunting him repeatedly.
Good, Lord knows that we can use every advantage.
Oh, you're no fun.
I'll walk down to the lake shore.
Okay.
He is not very fun, is he?
I endeavor to be as unfun as possible.
Yep, that sounds like you. So, you guys are going to go around in the water? Is that the plan?
Maybe. Maybe there's a cave. We can find the secret passage.
Is there any means of entrance above the door? Like, if you were to climb the tower?
Above the
door.
Oh,
there's a big gash, you said, right?
There is a big gash. So, yeah, it's about 80 feet tall total. And it's got, you can see, judging by where the windows are placed, you can judge that it's probably got about 4 levels inside. Each level is 20 feet high. There's also an intact slate tile roof. And the second, third, and fourth floors have arrow slits that are 6 inches wide, 3 feet tall, and 1 foot thick. The uppermost level overhangs the level below it and has a window boxes in addition to arrow slits.
Where's the gash at?
Pardon?
Where's the gash at?
The gash is on the third floor, northwestern corner.
And does it look enterable?
Yeah, so there's actually, as you kind of go around to the other side, you can see that there's some rickety scaffolding on that side of, as though somebody's already tried to go up there. Rotten wooden beams support the scaffolding, which groans and creaks with the slightest breeze. A series of ladders and platforms lead to a hole in the northwest wall of the third floor.
So at some point, someone was trying to actually fix this place. likely wasn't a natural occurrence, this break in the wall. So I'll turn to Aragal and ask, when you say that swimming in the lake lets you bypass the field, do you mean that it has something to do with the properties of the water, or there is some sort of other entrance that lets you pass through the field unaffected within the lake itself?
Wait, the name of the lake is after a figure in Wallachian history. Like Baratok means Bara the Holy, so there seems to be some sort of magical power inherent in the water for the faithful.
You guys also notice, if you're looking for ways to get inside, there is the door, and there's also a wagon outside too.
Just ram the wagon into the wall. That's the way to go. I'm gonna search the wagon real quick.
Okay, so you go over to the wagon. Under layers of mud, this wagon sports a fresh coat of purple paint, and its wheels have a fancy gold trim. A brass lantern hangs from each corner, and red drapes cover a tombstone-shaped window on each side. A steel padlock secures the back door, hanging from which is a cheap wooden sign that reads, "Keep Out."
So it's a whole carriage.
Yeah, it's like a Vardo, like a covered gypsy wagon. Actually, also, too, Roland, you were getting, from this wagon, you also picked up a little bit of conjuration magic.
Alright, so I feel as though I'm not going to be able to talk you out of opening that door,
Elena. Oh, of course.
So let's just be very careful about this.
Yeah, oh, of course.
All right. So, where's everybody going to be when Elena goes for it?
Well, I mean, I'm going to look at it first and see if there's any obvious traps or issues with trying to open it.
Okay.
Aragal will be behind cover with his crossbow.
Okay.
How thick is the anti-magic field around the tower?
It goes 5 feet from the tower. So you can definitely.
This wagon is outside of it, right?
It is, yeah. And you could, yeah.
Could you guys do me a favor and help me push this into the anti-magic field?
No.
Everyone who's not a small child.
Marcus. Do me a favor and help Marcus me push says. That into the anti-magic field? Marcus says, "Yeah, I can help you."
All right, so
I can cheer
into the anti-magic field.
Okay, so yeah, Marcus helps you push the wagon next to the tower in the anti-magic field.
And I will also look for non-magical traps as well.
Okay, where are you going to look for traps?
Around the lock, underneath the door, around the edges of the door, just everywhere, really. Elena would know better than me.
Okay.
Don't forget the axles underneath.
Ah.
Okay. Yeah, give me a perception check.
Good. The problem being that I'm terrible at perception and investigation.
Okay.
Really, everything that helped me find traps.
Yeah, you notice that there is definitely a handle on this little door, and you know, you go under, you check the axles, they look solid. You check around the door, and you don't find anything untoward. It looks like you can kind of see how this handle opens. It looks like it just kind of opens like a cupboard might open. And that's what you get from that.
All right. I'm going to attempt to pick the padlock with my thieves' tools.
Just a moment.
Wait, hold on.
Just a moment there, Elena. I'll take hold of your whip, and in a flash of light, it gains a very, very dim glow.
Nice.
This, truth be told, this spell never seemed all that useful to me in the academy, but it's clearly very important to you that you have a magic weapon.
It is. I'd like to do a lot of things.
Aww.
Thank you.
Okay, so where again? So Aragorn's hiding behind something with his crossbow drawn. Audrey is doing what?
I'm near my father and looking at the cage.
Okay.
I will urge her back, and I'll urge her. Audrey, you might want to step back as well.
Okay, I will try to look on the tower to see if there's any movement out there.
You don't see any. Give me a perception check. But
because this we make a ruckus, so the carriage was moved and slammed into the wall.
Good idea. Okay, yeah. So Marcus is going to go down the causeway and just keep an eye on the forest and see if anyone comes from that way.
No, he won't.
Why not?
Blind.
Oh yeah.
I'll have Poe do a quick circuit around the tower.
Okay. Yeah. So you just see the tower so that's where everybody is. Elena, what are you gonna do? You checked it out.
I'm gonna remove the sign that says "Keep Out" and hand it to Roland, or wherever. Take a look at that. See if there's anything on there. And I'm going to, despite knowing this is going to end badly since you've been asking where we're all standing, I'm going to pick the lock on my thief tools.
Okay. Give me a check.
Should I have an advantage? I don't know. I have my proficiency to it. I don't really know how picking locks works. Which check am I doing?
It's thieves tools. Dexterity check with. Or no, it's a thieves tools check, right? With dexterity?
Yeah, so it's just dexterity check plus proficiency.
Basically, yeah.
I think that'll probably do it.
Alright, yeah. You put your little lock in there, and you're kind of nervous because the DM was asking you where everybody was standing. And you can, feel each one of those pins move, and then you go to the next one and it moves to the side, and you go to the next one, you hit the last one and your pick turns and you it disengages the lock and it pops open. The lock pops open. So now the lock's in your hand and the door is still closed.
Okay.
I'm going to hunker down next to Aragorn.
Okay.
I take a couple steps back.
Okay. Wait, did Marcus also went away?
Marcus is 45 feet away on the causeway.
Oh, he's that far?
Yeah.
Okay.
A couple steps back. Oh, okay.
I'm the same.
You're going to be next to Marcus?
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. I'm going to take a couple steps back so I'm a square away and attempt, hopefully at like a badass, to open the door with my whip.
I love it. Okay, yeah. Give me an attack roll.
Plus one,
19.
Okay, good. Yeah, so your whip wraps around the handle, and the door opens. And as it does so, you hear the sound of glass breaking, and you soon see the entire wagon erupt in flame. You're going to need to give me a DC 12 Constitution saving throw.
Constitution?
Yeah.
And this applies if I'm 10 feet away from it?
Yeah, if you were within 5 feet, you would have had disadvantage on it, so you actually did help yourself.
Nice. Constitution is not my strong suit, though. So, hey.
Nice work. Okay. You take 23 points of fire damage as the thing explodes in a terrible ruckus.
You can You can reduce.
I have evasion yet.
Says. And that's her dex saves regardless. Do you have reflex?
I don't have anything that's going to help with this.
Whoa. It's a lot of damage.
We've had a short rest since the last time we played, though, right?
Yeah, I was just assuming you guys had a long rest, actually.
Yeah, we stayed overnight back in... Yeah. We stayed overnight back at Kresk.
Yeah.
That's not that bad, then.
No, you're fine. 23. You can get 23 damage standing on your head. No big deal.
Still, but it's huge explosion.
A big explosion, yeah. It's just like this huge, like... I'm not going to say mushroom cloud because it's not a mushroom cloud, but it is like a huge fireball erupts from the wagon.
Right. So the wagon did activate magic. Was it magic
You don't think it was magic because you think it was some sort of mechanical thing. It looks like it looked like it was just like loaded full of alchemist fire.
Yeah, because it was in the anti-magic zone and still exploded.
Yeah.
And now there's just like this way of keeping your stuff safe.
Yeah, there's just this smoking hole where the wagon used to be in the ground.
It was right up against the tower. What happened to the tower?
The tower, like the side of it that was next to it, got scorched. You can definitely see it scorched the stone, but it stayed in fair shape.
And so I will dash forward, pull off my jacket, and start beating at any fire that's left on Elena's body.
Okay. All right.
So yeah, will Aragol.
Okay. Yeah, you guys go over there and beat out the flames that are... I imagine, like... I don't know if you guys remember from D&D 3rd Edition, but there was a great picture where they had, like, a wizard, Mayali, like, playing with some kind of magic item, and it just, like, blew up in her face, and it shows, like, the soot all on her face and, like, her hair, like, singed. Oh, it was great. That's what I imagine Elena looks like.
She just kind of like sputters as they're like hitting her with their coats and things. Like, hey, okay.
Okay, I will mend your burned clothes.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
I'm not sure why someone thought that was a good idea to keep their things safe by causing them to explode, but learned a lesson, clearly.
All right.
It's less about keeping things safe and keeping their stuff safe and keeping their stuff from being taken.
Do I now see some movements in the tower?
You don't see any movement in the tower. You do since you're near the door. You do see the door, and I've linked it there. So if you'll go to that where I've linked, you'll see the picture of the door itself. The tower door is made of iron with no visible handles or hinges. In the middle of the door is a large embossed symbol, a connected series of lines with 8 stick figures set around it. Carved onto the lintel above the door is a word, Kazan. And Aragol remembers, oh yeah, Kazan, that's the name of the wizard.
Kazan. Come on.
There's nothing left where the cart was, huh?
Just a little smoking crater, yeah.
Just for no reason. All right.
Whoa, Elena, that was awesome. How did you do that?
That was pretty impressive.
Yeah, I mean,
yeah, there were parts of it.
I didn't think that the magic weapon spell would be that effective.
Underestimated it. Despite all of my efforts and nice rolls, I was fated to blow up no matter what I did. So
a nice roll, a 12 on perception is a nice roll, man.
Not that one. Fated to explode, regardless.
That's too bad. This was a really nice wagon. I would have liked ourselves.
Yeah, I could just never mind it. Were there any openings in the carriage?
Openings in the carriage?
Yeah, before it was old.
I guess it doesn't really matter now.
Yeah.
It's gone.
It was just the door, right? The one that...
That was all that you found.
All right, I'll take a closer look at the door. I'll take a close... without getting within the anti-magic field, I'll take a closer look at the door.
Well, Aragol's right there, and you can withstand a little little hair raisin.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So you can from outside the anti-magic field, you can still see the image that I posted in the chat.
Okay. So this tower has slings and windows. I could go and turn myself or someone into the fog to go around the tower to see if something's inside.
There's the anti-magic field.
I mean, outside of anti-magic field, just going 5 feet away from.
All right.
It would be hard to see inside because you'd be looking into a dark room from a arrow slit and the light outside.
You have
dark vision, though. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Yep. I'm with you.
Is there anything to distinguish between one end of the line at like 10 o'clock and the other end of the line at 3 o'clock? Different from each other?
What's that?
Okay, at 10 o'clock on this figure, the line ends. And at 3 o'clock, the other end of the line points there. So is there any difference between the 10 o'clock line and the three o'clock end of the line?
Give me a perception check. Or investigation, you choose.
Either of those will be equally. Oh no, I got +3 perception.
Okay. Yeah, so you bring you put your thumb up to it, and you kind of like measure it out with like thumbnail widths, and you're looking at it, and you're like, they look identical. Yeah.
I'll try to match any of these symbols to anything I might have seen in a book or anything like that.
Okay, give me I'll give you knowledge arcana or history.
Elena's probably. Oh, never mind. It's too late.
You've never seen anything like this before.
Okay. Sorry.
Go ahead.
While they're trying to figure out the door, I will use Gash's form.
Okay.
And fly around the tower slowly.
Sure. So the precocious little child says some words in a voice that doesn't even sound like her own, and as she does, it's like she just kind of dissolves into mist and starts to rise above you guys. I don't know if you've seen her use this spell before, but I imagine that would be interesting. Marcus seems a little bit. He kind of hears you dissolve, and he's like, he says, "Audrey, what's happened?"
She's just turned into mist.
You
I assume this is normal.
Dissolve.
Yeah, it sounds like this.
Can I talk or I can't?
I don't know. What does the spell say?
Yeah, I'm trying to.
I'm pretty sure. You can communicate telepathically, right?
Oh yeah, yeah. Okay.
You can't talk.
But... I can get spells or not.
This is the sound that the Vardo made when it blew up.
That can't talk or manipulate objects with any object. It's scary for me. I didn't hear anything.
There we go. Alright, so I'm going to say you can talk with your telekinesis or telepathy when you're in ghost.
Awakened mind.
Yeah, that's.
Yeah, the awakened mind is my.
Yeah, it works. It works. We'll just say it works.
Warlock.
Okay, so you speak to Marcus. Yeah, and reassure him. Okay, And he seems at rest. All right, so you float up. While you guys are looking at the door, Audrey floats up to the second floor. You can kind of peek into the second floor there, Audrey.
Yeah.
And you can see that there's a bunch of dust and cobwebs in there. And there's a wooden floor, which is badly rotted and partially collapsed. There doesn't seem to be much else of interest there. So you're on the second floor, and are you going to continue to head up?
Yeah, let's continue to get up.
All right, you continue to head up. What are you guys going to do down on the ground?
I am going to dip into the lake.
Okay. You crawl.
Very quickly.
Yep, you walk over and you dip, what, a foot in or something?
No, just dive in, fully immerse myself for just a second, and come back out.
Okay, you do that, and you're sopping wet.
Marigal watches with the side eye.
Okay.
Right. So I'll try stepping through. Now I'll try stepping through the anti-magic field.
All right, you don't feel anything stepping into the anti-magic field.
What, not even the hair raising?
The hair raising was only when you come back out.
Oh.
And so I'll try to conjure a bit of fire.
All right, you try to conjure fire inside the anti-magic field, and what would this sensation feel like? Yeah, it's like you're trying to sneeze. Like, you have the urge to sneeze, but you can't sneeze. That's what it feels like. And no fire is conjured.
Oh, well. I'll step back outside. And with a clap of my hands and a rush of wind, my clothes will dry themselves.
Okay, you do that.
I'm going to throw a grappling hook up at the gash.
Okay. So the gash has like a scaffold right in front of it. So it'd be very, very difficult to get a grappling hook to attach to the gash and not the scaffold.
Does the scaffolding itself look stable?
Not really.
Do you have any, let's see, if you have like a carpentry or anything?
I am a pirate that goes on ships.
I'll let you give me an intelligence check with proficiency. That would make sense that a pirate would know about, like, wooden structures.
Great.
Okay. That's enough to know, you know, basic information about it. You think that you think that somebody who's very light might be able to climb to the top of there and without issue, but you definitely think that there's a fairly low tolerance for weight on this thing. It is pretty old and moldy.
I will attempt, because our light person is currently even lighter and missed, to climb up the scaffolding while using the wall and my acrobatic skill to put as little weight on it as possible.
Okay.
And climb up as fast as I can.
So you start to do that. How much, you figure out how much you and your equipment weigh together, and we'll go to Audrey. Audrey, you...
Oh, wait, Ergo wants to do something.
Sure.
All right, so he muttered something about how this is probably stupid. But,
yeah.
Starting from the 10 o'clock figure, he will mimic that with his body. So, like,
okay.
His arms bent... and fingers pointing skyward,
right,
and his legs apart, and then he'll go to the 6 o'clock one and do one arm up,
put his arm down out. yep
yeah, and so on and so on, following the line to end at 3 o'clock.
Okay. Yes. So when you finish your little dance, what happens is the door, let's see, does it say how it opens? Yeah, so the door just kind of, like, you hear a latch move, and it just kind of slowly swings open into the lower floor.
Argal turns to the group and says, "This is incredible! I have invented the Macarena!"
Yeah, it opens, and you, as you do that, you turn to the group, and like this door on these really rusty hinges, like...
And the anti-magic field is completely unaffected?
Completely unaffected. All right.
Fantastic work there, Argal. All
right, on the... Hello. Argal, you look, on the first floor, the flagstone floor is strewn with debris, and a few old crates stand near the eastern wall. A torn curtain to the south partially obscures the tower vestibule. A 5-foot square indentation in the center of the floor contains 4 pulleys attached to taut iron chains that stretch up through a similarly sized hole in the rotted wooden ceiling. Standing next to the chains are 4 tall clay statues.
So both ends of the chain, so there's 4 pulleys. There's a chain running through them, and both of the ends of the chains are in the ceiling.
Yeah.
Erigal does not like how this looks.
Okay. Roland jumped in the water. Erigal figured out the door. Audrey checked out the second floor, and Elena went to start to climb. Okay, Elena, how much does everything weigh on you?
Hell, I'm not quite done, but it's probably less than 200 pounds.
Okay. Probably is good enough for me. All right, so you're able... You climb up, you take a couple steps, and you hear, like, the wood start to creak and sway as you step, and you... carefully and gingerly, like, lay your foot down, kind of the ball of your foot first, and then gently place your heel down, and you're just kind of slowly going so that you don't generate a lot of force suddenly.
Okay. I was planning to do some acrobatics on the side of the wall, but...
Yeah, you think if you did that and fell, it would be disaster.
Falling.
Yeah. Okay. So yeah. So if you go up like that, you're not gonna take any. You're not gonna have any risk of this thing breaking. All right. So you go up to the second floor. And you two. Do you have dark vision? What are you?
Me?
Yeah, it's you.
I'm a human.
Okay, so that's a no. So you can kind of you get up to the second floor, and you can see that there's the arrow slits, but you can't really see too well inside. Of course, Audrey could telepathically let you know what she saw.
And I call up and ask, "Do you have any torches or a lantern with you?"
I do have a lantern.
All right. So you don't need me. So you don't need my help.
No, not usually.
All right then. I'm just gonna go in with Argal.
Okay. So you go. The two of you go down into the first floor. And then Audrey floats up to the third floor. Audrey, you see into the. You're looking into the arrow slits in the third floor. Time and elements have all but destroyed this chamber, leaving a gash in the northwest wall and slimy black mildews on the wall. The wooden floor is completely rotten and has begun to fall away in places. Okay. What are the Argal and Roland? What are you guys going to do on the first floor?
Are all the statues identical?
Yes, they're all identical, but they're all facing in towards the middle of the room.
And there isn't just a door on the or stairs on the other side of this room or anything like that.
There are no stairs in this room. There's just some crates and then like a 5-foot by 5-foot depression in the middle of all four of those clay statues, and they're all kind of like looking towards it.
Are they armed?
They're not armed. Their hands are around the they're gripping the chain.
Wait, so they have hands but no arms?
Out.
Okay, so like the chain moves freely through their hands?
It actually doesn't look loose. It looks like they're gripping it hard as and it's, you know, the path of the chain is deforming in their grip. If that makes sense.
Wait, could you repeat that? You cut out for a second there. The path of the chain is what?
So it's, you can tell just by the path of the chain that the statues are not, it's not just going through their hands. The statues are actually gripping the chain.
So the between the ceiling and the chain leading up, or in this case down to their hands, that is taut, while the chain leading down and away from their hands to the pulley and back up, that is slack.
It's all pretty taut, but you can just tell that they're holding. They're actually gripping the chain rather than it's just loosely going through their hands. And yeah, there's you can see from where you're standing, you can look up and there's a 5 foot by 5 foot, the same size as the indentation is on the ground. There's a 5 foot by 5 foot hole in the floor of the second and the third floor, and then on the fourth floor, you can't see through that hole. That's just like a wooden, just like a 5 foot by 5 foot wooden thing that you can see up there. Tile, essentially.
So is it possible that there's a platform in the middle of them? It is.
It looks like that's exactly what it is. Like a 5 foot square wooden platform. Yeah.
Aragorn will look at Roland and say, look, this is Vistani innovation. I have invented the elevator.
I wouldn't say invented.
Well, this was built by my people. You could tell by the architecture.
Well, sure, but you say I as though you did this, even though we just walked into this room. Sorry, semantics. I'll try to say... We should stay focused. So, does it look like any part of this mechanism is clearly meant to be handled?
Give me an investigation check.
Oh yeah, the magic isn't on the whip isn't going to work anymore.
No.
Oh damn it.
Okay. So you're looking around and you kind of go to the edge of that little indentation. And you're looking around for some way to go up there, and as you do that, Roland, the clay statues come to life and they, in unison, they start to put slack in the chain and lift the chain up, and as they do so. The wooden platform descends down all three floors and sits into that indentation in the floor. And then they stop moving.
This is extremely powerful magic. And turned to such mundane purpose.
Yeah.
I'll very much like to meet the wizard, the wizard who created all of this.
Okay, so you guys.
Onto the platform.
Okay, so you guys okay, act. You guys do wait, that. Wait, now wait. It's time to.
Actually, sorry. Before I do that, I want to make a quick run through of the room, checking through these. Well, you said they're broken and everything, but just making sure that nothing.
Yeah, you just kind of like knock on the crates, and it seems like they're all empty.
Okay.
Yeah.
So yeah, I'll just step onto the platform.
Fine. Okay. You step on the platform. We'll go to Alana. So Alana, you kind of gingerly make your way up this scaffolding, taking care not to, like, you step on one thing and then you take one step onto the platform in one area and it's really rotten, and you part of it breaks away, and you quickly, you know, pull your foot back just in time. You didn't put any weight on it, and then you keep moving along. You get to the third floor, and you see what Audrey saw. Assuming, have you lit up your lantern yet, or no?
Well, once I get up there, I'll.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So you're at the northwestern corner where there's that big gash in the wall, and you can see just like slimy mildew all over the walls, and then the wooden floors, rotten and gross. And as you get up there, you see this wooden platform jerkily move down past you, and it goes down, and you can hear it move down to the first floor. In the middle, in the middle of that room.
I'm gonna step into the room.
I'll
try to check that axiom first before I step into the room.
Okay.
Look around.
Yeah, give me another one of your obvious. Yeah, give me one of your perception with or knowledge with not advantage, proficiency check for being a pirate. Okay, yeah, you know, you can see that the wood there on that floor is a lot weaker than even the scaffold. You say that just looking at it, each section, each 5-foot section, can probably support a maximum of anywhere between 25 to 75 pounds. You're not too sure, but you know that you would crash right through it.
How are the walls looking and the ceiling?
Like I said, the walls are slick with mildew, and the ceiling is made out of wood as well. But the ceiling wood actually looks to be in better condition.
Is there any candelabras or hanging fixtures?
No, there isn't. No.
Damn it! All right. Well,
there is a hole. There is now a 5-foot by 5-foot hole in the ceiling. Directly in the center of it, because that platform has now gone down to the first floor. And again, there are also chains which connect each corner of that platform, which are also in the center of the room. And in case you were wondering how far it would be to jump, to the closest chain, it would be about an 8-foot jump. The problem is you wouldn't be able to get a running start because of the scaffold is not that long.
I'd like to attempt to wrap my grappling hook around the chain.
Okay. Yeah, give me a... Well, we'll do that next. Okay. Audrey, what are you going to do?
Did I hear something inside the tower?
You don't hear anything? Or... You can hear Elena getting up there and getting ready to buckle her swash.
Okay. I will move up to the final floor. Already.
The final floor.
Okay. Yeah, just to see what's that. So, Marcus didn't go in, right? He's standing outside.
Marcus is, yeah, keeping an eye on everything outside.
Okay.
Just in
case, so I can communicate with him, because I think I must see the person to communicate.
Yeah. He's out front of the front door. He says, let me know if you need me. I'll be here.
Okay. For now, nothing. Just old floors and
okay.
Empty rooms.
All right, fine. So,
yeah, I will slowly go up.
Going to go up. Okay. So you can see in through the arrow slits here, and there's actually some like larger windows. Unlike the levels below, this room shows signs of recent habitation, and although the place reeks of mold and mildew, it has plenty of creature comforts, including a cozy bed, a desk with a matching chair, bright tapestries, a large iron stove with plenty of wood to feed it. and light enters through arrow slits as well as through dirt-caked windows with broken shutters. Other features of the room include a standing suit of armor and a wooden chest. Old wooden rafters bend under the weight of the tower roof, which has somehow remained intact. Mounted to the rafters are pulleys, which iron chains hang that support the tower's elevator platform. All right, so that's what you see. People on the first floor, what are you guys going to do? You're standing next to the elevator, which is now set into that indentation in the middle of the ground.
Yes. How do you get into the room?
How would you get into the room? It seems like the only way to get in there would be the elevator.
Oh, so there's a hole in the ground.
Hole in the ground, in the floor, yeah, right in the middle. Yep.
Okay.
All right, so
I will just say to the Marcus, I see a well-suited room for suitable for living here, but no one's here. That's all.
Okay. He confirms he received your message. All right. So what is? What are the people on the first floor going to do?
I'm going to shout up through the hole in the ceiling, in the roof, and say, "Hey, we found an easy way up to the top."
Okay.
Just hold on a second. This platform will take us all the way up, it seems.
I'm already up here, you slowpoke.
Okay, all right. Just hold on a second. We'll be right up.
Okay.
So, Argal, you coming?
Well, yes.
Okay.
Argal draws his short sword and gets on this platform.
Okay.
Right. You said it's 5x5.
It's 5x5. Oh yeah, easily. Yeah. Yeah. It's like a normal elevator. Normal elevators aren't even 5x5, but yeah, two of you can fit on for sure.
Right.
Okay, so you guys are standing on the platform. Now what are you going to do?
So does it not just start rising by itself?
Nope.
Ah, damn it. I will try to think of what sort of trigger, if these things would work off of some sort of magical trigger, or rather...
There's no magic here.
How an enchantment like this would work. Maybe voice activated or something?
You can certainly try that.
You can try to think about it?
Well, yeah, you think about it. You're not sure. This is all Greek to you, but yeah, voice activation seems as good as anything.
Just thinking, I'll just turn to the statues and say, up.
Okay. Rise. You say up, and as you do that, they come back to life and start pulling the chain the other way, and you guys jerkily, it's not a smooth ride at all, it's just kind of lowers, and it's just every time it goes up, it's like cooking, 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 and they start to bring you up. You get up to the third floor, yeah, you get up to the third floor, and Elena, you see their heads kind of rise into view as the elevator goes up. What are you going to do?
I wouldn't step off of that, whatever you're on, if I were you. I'd stay there.
I will retract.
I'm still going to grapple the...
Okay, give me an acrobatics check. That makes sense.
All right, I will stand by to catch her in case she overshoots or anything.
Sure. Okay, that's fine. So yeah. You whip your grappling hook around, and it kind of goes and hooks on the one of the chains, and you give it a tug, and you swing over, and you manage to swing yourself onto the platform with the other three with pretty incredible flourish.
Well, easier than I thought I was going to be, honestly.
Yeah. You can do cool
shit. I was gonna do a whole tight rope, walk my way over there.
Yeah, I don't think you'd have time to do that.
No, I don't.
I'll make sure that everything about the grappling hook is unhooked and the rope is fully retracted so it doesn't get stuck anywhere.
Good idea. Okay, yeah, you do that and you recover the grappling hook. Okay, you guys, the three of you make it to the fourth floor. And I'll say it again.
Take the easy way to the top, sister.
Yeah.
I keep saying sister like a sassy black woman.
Right, as you would. I'll say it again because there's a lot there. Unlike the levels below, this room shows signs of recent habitation. Although the place reeks of mold and mildew, it has plenty of creature comforts, including a cozy bed, a desk with a matching chair, bright tapestries, and a large iron stove with plenty of wood to feed it. Light enters through arrow slits as well as through dirt-caked windows with broken shutters. Other features of the room include a standing suit of armor and a wooden chest. Old wooden rafters bend under the weight of the tower roof, which has somehow remained intact. Mounted to the rafters are pulleys which hang iron chains to support the tower's platform. All right, so what did you guys see?
And so it seems as though the wizard isn't dead or anything of the kind. He simply isn't here right now, so I'll suggest that we not grab everything that's nailed down.
Well, okay.
That sounds more like a guideline than hard and fast rules.
Nothing trust says me. We can't look and see what's here before trust we make any decisions.
Trust me when I say that a selective anti-magic field is astonishingly powerful. Is an astonishingly powerful sorcery. This is not someone that we want.
There's no evidence. Yes, which is why we shouldn't step off this elevator just yet. And then Elena's going to do that.
Right. So
yeah,
Audrey. Audrey, what are you going to do? You're still a gas cloud outside of the fourth floor.
I would like to comment that, but I can't speak, so I will just go down.
You're going to go down where?
To the ground.
To the first floor? Okay. All right, you go down to the ground, and are you going to reform into a girl?
Yeah.
Okay. You do so. You could just reform. You could reform on the platform with them by going through the arrow slit, since you are gas. It's up to you.
Wouldn't the magic field?
Yeah.
Oh, yes, yes, you're right. Never mind.
Yeah, I can't.
Oh, yeah. I didn't even think of that. Okay. Good. Thank you for keeping me honest. All right, yeah. So you're down on the first floor. You're turned into a girl.
I show Marcus to go inside.
He says, okay. So he turns around and goes with you to the first floor. So you guys are inside next to the clay statues.
Okay, I didn't hear anything about the talking, so I asked Marcus how did they make it work?
He says, well, it seems like they just kind of, if they wanted to be serviced by the elevator, they just kind of stood at the lip and expected it to come down, and it did come down, and then they said up, and it went back up. He says, but they might be still up there on the elevator, so I don't want to bring it down just yet until they've moved off it.
Yeah, good point.
And then he yells up to you guys. He says, hey, if you can hear me, yell back down and let us know when we can use the elevator.
Working on it.
Can we hear him?
Yeah, you can. It's like kind of thin wood and you can.
We're working on it. The DM stopped us from stepping off the elevator.
Okay. All right. What are you three going to do?
I threw some ball bearings around.
Okay.
Traps.
You throw some ball bearings out of your bag and scatter them around the room. You hear the sound of ball bearings on wood, which sounds as cool as you'd imagine it would. And they just kind of go in all different directions, and you don't find, they don't set off any traps or anything.
Well, there's no non-magical traps. Roland, I think the rest is probably your.
Roland? Roland? Tim, you there? I guess Tim is disconnected. Aragal, what are you going to do? What's happening right now? Am I disconnected? That's a yes. Hate to see that happen. Okay. Sorry, I got disconnected again. What are you guys going to do?
I can't just cast I can't cast detect magic here.
That is correct.
So I will instead look for. I'll think back during my abjuration classes, obvious places to put runes of warding, like just the floor immediately surrounding the elevator, maybe the stove, maybe the suit of armor.
Okay, yeah, give me a knowledge arcana check.
Especially the suit of armor. Nailed it.
I didn't see it.
27.
You got 27? Okay, for some reason it didn't roll. Okay, but I believe you. All right. You can see there's a you can see some magical rune on the armor, on the belt, where the belt would be at least. And it's something that definitely denotes some kind of animation magic, and you think that is a suit of animated armor. That doesn't necessarily mean that it's hostile or going to attack or anything, but you know that was created with magic.
All right, we can't. So I point out is that the only thing that I see?
That's the only thing that you think is some sort of magically touched.
And so I point that out to the others and say, well, we can't. I wouldn't be able to necessarily say that it is going to come to life and kill us as soon as we take a step into this room, but I can't say that it won't do that. So we should assume that it will.
All right. Does anyone here have a saw or a hammer?
Is there any way for us to? Yeah, so. Or does it. Is the belt itself made of metal or leather or what?
Yeah, that rune is made of metal, and it's kind of on the lower part of the breastplate.
Sorry, you said belt, right? It's on the belt?
Belt, yeah, but I don't know if plate armor actually has a belt, so it's just in that area.
How sturdy was this floor again?
This floor looked in pretty good condition.
So it wouldn't be easy to destroy the floor.
Then. Correct, yeah.
Yeah, whoever lives here lives here, so I'll assume the floor is pretty sturdy.
I had a saw and some time.
So there's no way for us to just knock the belt off of this thing?
Yeah, so your remembrance of animated armor magic makes you realize that if you were to attack it by doing something like that, it would, depending on the imperatives placed into this thing by its creator, that might be almost certainly something that would make it attack.
It's just an animated armor. We fought one of those in Death House, didn't we?
Yeah, you did.
Take it.
Well, I can't use magic, so we might want
to put
Marcus in here. And also, Aragal's poison wouldn't work.
Pretty sure I can kill an armor on my own. Even at half health.
But you don't know what Death House is, Alana, so you don't have
that
knowledge.
That's true. I fought an animated armor before. What kind of pirate do you think I am?
This could also be. Maybe it's an iron golem. Bum, 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 bum. All right, what are you guys going to do? You're still hanging out at the elevator. Marcus yells up, can we do it yet?
I'm going to, how far away is the bed?
The bed is about 4 feet away from the southwestern corner.
I can't even jump that far. I use this pirate, am I? I got nothing other than just, like, walking into the room. I don't know about you guys.
I keep wanting to use prestidigitation to try to mess with the rune itself, but...
Yeah, but
I think
you'll
be a safe. I think it'll be a smart idea to get Marcus up here to fight the armor.
I can jump. I'm just gonna.
Wait. So is Lena? Does Lena think the floor is lava?
Well, you never know.
All right. What are you guys gonna do? Hello? Fuck. Sorry, I think I disconnected again. All right, what are you guys going to do?
They were trying to jump on the bed.
Okay.
She's going to jump from the elevator to the bed, just in case.
All right, give me an athletics check.
To jump 4 feet? I can jump 4 feet with a standing jump.
Okay. All right, you make it to the bed.
I did it.
Give me an acrobatics check because, you know, if you're jumping on something.
I'll do a flip, that'll be awesome.
Yeah. Also, too, like, if you jump onto a bed from 4 feet away, like, if the bed's not nailed down, it could just, like, slip out from under. Okay, that's fine. Yeah, you jump on the bed, and then the bed kind of bounces a little bit, and you jump on the bed a little bit, and you're fine. All right, you're standing on the bed. Nothing untoward happened.
The floor is still covered in ball bearings.
Ball bearings.
Yeah, it would be.
It's not covered. I didn't pour the entire bag out.
They're mostly like on the edges though, because you know that's just how they'd end up rolling.
Yeah, well, I went through like probably 10 total.
Yeah.
Are you coming, Aragol? What do you do?
Yeah. What do you want me to roll?
Presumably acrobatics.
Are you gonna jump onto the bed as well?
Yeah.
Okay, go ahead. Acrobatics check.
I just clothesline them.
All right, yeah. You just two monkeys jumping on the bed now.
I just look at you, I'm like, what are you doing?
What? I'm keeping you safe.
All right.
Archie can't wait anymore. She will try to stay down.
Okay. Yeah, so the elevator starts to, it slowly jerks down one arm length. Roland, you're startled by this. What are you going to do?
Is there something more stable?
No, I'm pretty sure I said that out loud, like, down.
Yes, you did. Okay, Roland, what are you going to do?
Is there something more stable than the bed to jump onto?
Not really. There's like a desk and a little, like a, not an oven. What's it called?
A stove?
A stove, yeah. Like a stove type thing with a fireplace. But the bed is probably the best, the most stable thing.
If we're assuming the floor is lava, which really, I don't know where we are.
Well, you, You went first.
She's just being dramatic. I was going to pull, I'm going to try to pull the blanket up and throw it over the armor. Just in case.
Okay, so what are you going to do, Roland?
I am going to start, actually just climb onto the chain so that I don't actually drop down with the platform. I'll just stay up hanging there.
Okay.
Or rather, so, how thick is the chain?
Go down too,
so
right?
Here's the thing is, so there's basically two lengths of chain that you can grab onto. One of those lengths of chain is going down with the elevator. The other one is going up towards the pulley. So which one are you going to grab onto?
The one that's going down.
Okay, so you grab onto the length of chain that's going down, and you're slowly lowered down to the first floor, and you see Marcus and
no,
Audrey
I mean,
there.
I'm going to climb up so that I stay in the same position.
I see. Okay, I get you. Okay, yeah, give me just an athletics check.
Ridiculous. So we're jumping on the bed, and you're climbing.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, that's good enough. All right, so yeah, you're able to, like, climb at the same rate that the clay statues are bringing it down.
You said this is happening really slowly, right?
Slowly and, like, jerkily. It's moving around. It's, like, 5 feet per round or so. Yeah, it has. Okay, so the you're hanging there, and then Marcus and Audrey are watching the platform slowly move down onto the floor. People on the bed, I guess, are going to get another turn to do something as that lowers down. Go ahead. What do you guys want to do?
I'm going to... The bed has blankets on it, right?
Sure, yeah.
All right. Well, okay, can I roll something to see how much I do know about it? Animated armor?
Yeah, give me an arcana check.
Probably not much, but...
Okay. That's enough to know that sometimes animated armor is imbued with a command word that allows it to activate and become under the command of whoever speaks that command word.
I'm mainly wondering if she knows...
Say that again, Roland.
All right, I'll try saying the name of the wizard.
What was the wizard's name?
Hazan!
Okay,
that's
so,
it.
So you say, Roland says Kazan, and as you say that, Roland, the animated armor comes to life and then brings its right arm up in a salute to you.
Right. I don't remember telling you the command word thing, but that's cool.
To be fair, I got a much higher arcano.
That's true. That's true.
You did. I just wanted to tie sheets around its legs so it couldn't walk. That's all I wanted.
You could still do that.
I mean, yeah, you could if you wanted to.
The main thing I was trying to figure out with their contract was to see if I could remember if they need their faces to see. So if I threw a blanket over its head, would it have any effect or not?
Oh.
Do I know that?
I didn't want a metagame, so...
I'm going to say that you don't know that, and because I don't even know that, so...
I do, but Elena doesn't.
I mean, why wouldn't it just be able to take the to toss the blanket off?
It would waste a turn doing so. Or waste a... All
right.
Bonus hit.
Well, irrelevant.
Yeah, it's right, doesn't matter anymore.
All right, so I'll just hop off of the chain, being careful not to land on any of the ball bearings.
Okay, so you hop onto the ground. The floor is not lava. You are safe.
Yeah.
And I thought all those... and I thought all those animation classes would be for nothing.
Okay, as you guys are getting an animated armor on your side, the platform lowers into the inset on the first floor and allows Marcus and Audrey to stand on it.
Come on, Papa, let's go.
All right, Marcus gets on there, and Marcus says, up! And as he says that, the platform raises up and heads towards the fourth floor.
I'll shout down and say, do not step onto the third floor.
Marcus says, noted. All right. So you guys get up there. What are you guys going to do? You're all on the fourth floor now.
Tell the armor to open the chest, Roland.
I'll do so.
Okay.
Well, since the floor is safe, Aragorn will check between the, I guess between the mattress and the box spring to see if any goodies are hidden.
Yeah, perception check, and while you do that, the animated armor follows your orders, Roland, and goes over to the chest, and chest is unlocked, and the animated armor opens the chest, and that happens. Aragal does not see any goodies underneath the bedspring.
Apparently, I'm no longer standing on the bed, so I will look into the chest.
What, how's that song go again? Like, two little monkeys jumping.
Yeah, that's why I said monkeys on the bed. Okay, so you go over there. Elena, you look inside the chest, and the first thing that strikes you is this aroma of lavender just, like, hits you like a pound of bricks. It smells like my English teacher. But anyway, that's neither here nor there. And then you see inside is a severed human head.
Oh, good.
Its flesh is a waxy complexion, and it looks to be very well preserved. You think maybe that's what all this lavender smell is.
Elena,
what's in the box?
Elena was like, looks at the Roland and is like, could you ask the armor to push it to pick up what's in there and put it aside so I can look underneath it?
All right, so I'll ask the armor to do so.
Okay, the armor puts its mailed fist and just kind of grabs the hair of the head and lifts it out of the box.
You also lift the head out of the box.
Yeah.
Oh, so that's what was in the box.
I'm just going to keep looking in the box and ignore the head.
Is this someone we know?
No, but Aragal, you give me a history check.
The wizard.
It's bar talk or whatever.
Man or a woman or
history, huh?
Mm-hmm.
It's probably bar or whatever.
Yeah.
Okay, Aragal. You don't know anything other than the fact that this guy has the dark hair and the ruddy cheeks and the complexion of a Vistana. You're almost certain this is a Vistana.
So is it a man or a woman?
It's a man.
Is this like some kind of cultural thing?
No, it's not. You know that it's someone who, you know, it's a Vistana, but you've never met this person in your life. But you definitely know that it's one of, and this isn't to say, I say it's one of your people, but that isn't to say that like all the Vistani are like friends and get along. A lot of the different groups of Vistani aren't friends. They're just like any other group of people who have, you know, hopes and dreams and aspirations and have differing opinions on things. So
and just hate the fuck out of each other.
You're right. So
duly noted.
Okay.
So it's a served head dipped into the lavender.
Yeah, it just has like it just has been embalmed with something that smells of lavender.
And it's still preserved, like
preserved excellently. Yes. Yep.
What else is in the box?
Nothing okay, else is in the box.
God damn it.
Aragorn asks to...
No, sorry, there is a map in the box, and the map is basically the map that you guys are on right now.
Does it say you are here or something?
Nope, but I will triple your light radius.
Yay.
Fantastic. So I will look for... So what's in the desk? Books, scrolls, journals?
More desks.
Yeah.
It's like a nesting desk.
There's a drawer full of tiny desks.
So you're looking around for journals and stuff. You can see that it looks like you don't see any stuff inside that desk, which is very odd, and that to Roland that would signify that why would you have a desk if you don't have anything in it? And then Roland kind of thinks, well, maybe somebody's trying to hide something, and then so he kind of looks over at the fireplace. And you know, you can see that there's some ashes in the fireplace and like maybe a little slip, some paper over there as well.
All right, so I'll open the fireplace and start digging, rooting through the ashes.
Okay. You find a burned piece of a journal. And it says the following. This is... Buckle up, because this is going to be a while. All right.
Is that what it says?
No.
he already said it's the following.
Okay. For more than 3 decades now, I have undertaken to investigate and expose creatures of darkness to the purifying light of truth and knowledge. Hero, I am named in some circles, sage and master hunter. I am called in others. That I have survived countless supernatural assaults is seen as a marvel among my peers. My name is spoken with fear and loathing amongst my foes. In truth, this virtuous calling began as an obsessive effort to destroy a vampire that murdered my child, and it has become for me a tedious and bleak career. Even as my life of hunting monsters began, I felt the weight of time on my weary shoulders. Today, I am a man who has simply lived too long. Like a regretful lich, I found myself inexorably bound to an existence I sought out of madness, and seemingly must now endure for all eternity. Of course I shall die, but whether I shall ever rest in my grave haunts my idle thoughts and torments me in my dreams. I expect that those who think me a hero will change their minds when they know the whole truth about my life as a hunter of the unnatural. Nevertheless, I must reveal here and now that I have been the indirect yet certain cause of many deaths and the loss of many good friends. Mistake me not, I do not merely feel sorry for myself, rather, I come to grips with the devastating realization. I now see that I am the object of a baleful Vistani curse. More tragically, the nature of this hex is such that I have not borne the brunt of it. Instead, far worse, those who surround me have fallen victim to it. I have related the tragic story of how my only child, Erasmus, was taken by the Vistani and sold to a vampire. I explain how Erasmus was made a minion of the Night Stalker, and how it was my miserable part to free him from that fate at the point of a stake. What I have neglected to illuminate before is how I tracked Erasmus's kidnappers across the land, or how I extracted Erasmus's whereabouts from them. In fact, the Vistani took Erasmus with my own unwitting permission. They had brought an extremely ill member of their tribe to me one evening and insisted that I treat him. But I was unable to save the young man's life. In fear of their retribution, I begged the Vistani to take anything of mine if they would withhold their terrifying powers, of which I knew nothing. To my lasting astonishment, they chose to surreptitiously take my son in exchange for their loss. By the time I realized what had occurred, they were already an hour gone. Incensed beyond reason, I strapped the body of the dead young man to my horse and doggedly followed the Vistani caravan through the woods, naively allowing the sun to set before me without seeking shelter from the night. Shortly after darkness fell, I was beset by undead that would have slain me had not their master, a lich, intervened and spared my life, for reasons that I do not completely understand. He somehow detected me, and with his powerful magic took control of a pack of zombies that wandered into the forest. He spoke to me through the mouths of the dead things and placed a magic ward against undead on me. then animated the dead Vistana and bade it to tell me where I could find its people. Unfortunately, I say in hindsight, the plan worked. I found the child stealers, and my unwelcome entourage included a growing horde of voracious undead that could not touch me, thanks to the Lich's ward. When I found the caravan, I threatened to set the zombies on the Vistani unless they returned my dear boy. They replied that he had been sold to the vampire Baron Mitas. Something inside me snapped. I released the zombies, and the entire tribe was eaten alive. Yet the story has not ended. Before she died, the leader cursed me, saying, "Live you always among monsters, and see everyone you love die beneath their claws." Even now, so many years later, I can hear her words with a painful clarity. A short time later, I found my dear Erasmus made into a vampire. He begged me to end his curse, which I did with my heavy heart. The darkness had torn him from my loving arms forever, and I foolishly believed that the curse had extracted its deadly toll. I wept until an insatiate desire for vengeance filled the bottomless rift in my heart. That's it.
That is a
lot. So, like anyone in my normal diary range, then.
So, that is a lot to survive being burned.
Yeah, it's like it's like two pages.
All right, so I will use prestidigitation to try and maybe salvage more, and if not, just fix this up so it won't.
Okay. So you are able to determine. You're able to get a name of who this belongs to. And it says, Journal of Dr. Rudolf Van Richten.
Aragol has been examining the head, by the way.
The head? Okay. It's not somebody you recognize, but you think that it's probably, because it's not somebody you recognize, you think it's got to be from a different tribe.
Audrey will try to yell at the head. Speak.
Does Audrey have any magic that will let her speak to this creature?
No, it's just for fun.
Okay. It's just for fun.
I guess Aragorn will try to speak to it in Vistani, like greet it in Vistani.
Okay.
I mean, nothing is working here because of the magic field, right?
Correct, yeah.
Yeah.
All right. What are you going to say in Vistani to the head?
The traditional Vistani greeting of may the asses pulling your wagon always point north.
Okay. You say that and it doesn't. The head does not respond.
All right, I turn to Aragorn and say, "Does the name Dr. Rudolf Van Richten mean anything to you?"
Aragorn, it does not. And so, Roland, are you gonna share with Aragorn anything that was in that journal? Or are you gonna keep that to yourself?
All of the Vistani murdering, you mean?
Yeah.
I first want to ask. Maybe ask our Vistani friends if they know who this guy is.
So Aragorn is not familiar with Rudolf Van Richten, but. Yeah, that's all you'd know from that information.
Sounds like a filthy foreigner. No righteous Vistani would have such a name.
Racist.
Aragorn, you do know the legend of the pack of zombies that was set upon a Vistani pack or tribe, but since you haven't read the journal entry, you don't know that these two things are related.
It wasn't my tribe, was it?
No, it wasn't yours. It was a different one.
Well, this has been a fruitful endeavor.
And it seems odd that a nomadic people would have strong feelings about foreigners.
It's a fair point.
Now, did Elena's search for hidden compartments come up with anything?
Could you give me a perception check, Elena?
Nope.
Nope. Don't find anything cool.
Audrey will try and look around.
Okay, Audrey.
See under the bed or something like that.
All right. Audrey painstakingly looks under each pillow and each bit of bedding, searching everything around the bed and underneath for any signs of any loot or traps or anything of the norm. Of the sort. Go ahead.
Here we go.
Okay, Audrey, you don't find anything.
Alright, so I'll check outside the windows to see if there is any sort of incredibly ill-timed return on the wizard's part.
Doesn't seem like it.
It seems like it. Wyatt?
Yes?
What did you say?
It doesn't seem like you don't see anything outside the windows.
Okay, so this journal was not from the wizard, but from some doctor. Rudolph.
Right?
Yes, so who is Kazan?
The wizard who built the wizard who built this tower. I assume.
And how did he get the journal from the doctor?
I haven't showed you the journal yet.
Marcus says...
Oh, sorry, sir.
Marcus says, Kazan, that reminds me. My sun sword, I think when we identified it, there was... it had something to do with him. I think that Strahd gave the sword to Kazan to destroy, but he never did. I think maybe Kazan was maybe sympathetic at least to Strahd.
Right. What do we know exactly about the sword?
Elena sort of just brings up, we can talk about this stuff literally anywhere else that isn't the scene of the place where we are stealing this armor from.
That's a fair point.
Wait, so this weapon, this secret weapon of yours, is the sun sword?
Yeah, it was the, like I said, I think it was Kazan Marcus, was supposed to.
Would Marcus have just said this aloud?
Maybe not. Maybe he'd go over to I guess he probably would have said that privately to Roland, but the cat was already out of the bag earlier.
Really? Because I'm thinking, and I can't remember any time where that actually happened. We've been going through great pains to make sure that no one outside of us knows about the sword.
Us being
great pains.
Like the
family.
Yes. Somebody definitely said something.
Hey, I'm pretty sure it was Elena, but it's not. Specifically, the sun sword, but
it was Audrey at Kizik.
Right.
She just blamed it out.
Yeah.
Something about the sword. She just said, "What about the sword?"
Right. Okay, so I guess maybe Marcus wouldn't have heard that. Wouldn't have known that the cat's out of the bag. So Marcus would have gone to Roland and kind of whispered, hey, I think Kazan was supposed to destroy this sword but did not do that for whatever reason.
Right. So Elena's right. We should leave. I don't think we're even really stealing anything. I mean, we're not taking the head with us, are we?
No.
Why not?
No! Why? As he puts it in his pack.
All right, let me answer your question with another question. Why?
It might be useful.
The head?
Ooh.
Well, you never know.
Can I transfer my unseen servant into the head?
We're still under an. We're still under
a. Oh, good. I went
anti magic field.
Oh yeah. Yeah. God damn it.
Yeah. But I don't see why you couldn't later on.
Yeah.
What are you talking about?
He had a doll be his unseen servant instead of just the normal.
Yeah, I just reusing the ritual for unseen servant to move my doll.
Yeah. Well, I guess not really unseen. It's definitely a servant though. Yeah. All right. So.
So we are taking. Are we taking the head?
Ergo.
I went. Hey, I went away for a second there. I couldn't hear anything.
All right. Who has the head?
Aragol has the head.
Aragol has the head in his inventory. Okay, great. You guys are taking the head. Roland, are you going to command the armor to follow you?
All right, but I don't think this is a good idea.
I do.
Why not? We can leave a note that I don't know.
That's why you always leave a note.
If we take this thing, we are definitely not leaving a note.
Dear powerful wizard, we accidentally blew up your cart and broke into your house and pilfered a head and a suit of magical armor. Please do not kill us.
It's good.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. Blast them to hell. Blast them to hell. Take everything that's not nailed down and sink the ship.
Just a second.
To the animated armor and ask it, can you leave this tower?
Okay. All right. Sorry about that. My girlfriend came in. Okay. She's drunk. Her teeth are bright pink, and she's been drinking rosé. So we'll see what happens. Okay. All right. So Aragol has the head in his backpack. Roland has activated the. Are you having the suit of armor follow you then?
I'm gonna ask it. Can you leave the tower?
It nods.
Yes.
It nods yes.
All right. I guess that's good enough for me.
Wait, Roland. Did you share the diary with us?
No.
No, not yet. Okay, then never mind.
So Roland's the only person who knows what the journal says. All right, so the armor nods yes. All
right. What was that?
Sorry, my phone keeps... I kept locking the screen, which apparently makes everything go silent. Okay.
All right, you guys gonna... do what?
All right, so I'm just saying... All right, but I'll warn you that if the wizard ever comes back for his armor, he is going to have a much better command over it than I am.
Yes, yes. We'll worry about that when that happens or doesn't happen.
Okay.
Come on, Roland. Let's go.
All right. So you guys gonna stand onto the platform? And then what?
Maybe not all at once.
Okay.
We can make it if we squeeze together.
Yeah, you could. Okay, what are you guys going to do? You're sitting on the platform.
Down.
All right, you say down, and it starts to sink down, gets on the first floor. Everybody gets off. Everybody's happy and safe. What you going to do?
We're gonna go where we were originally going before we started on this detour.
That was a good, pretty fun detour, though, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Got animated armor and everything.
So you guys start to go across the causeway, and
the magic is back.
No, it's not back.
It isn't. You said it's only 5 feet out from the tower.
Right? Oh yeah, yeah, magic. You can use magic. Yes, that is a true fact. Okay, let me make a little. I guess I won't need to yet. Okay, so.
time for more rolls.
You guys get off the tower and you start to go across the causeway, and as you do, you hear the sound of wolves. What are you going to do? You're on the causeway.
I reflexively do a backflip.
They're coming from the forest, right?
Correct.
They're not wolf mermaids or anything?
Yes, that
oh my god.
That tracks.
Wait, what happened?
We're being hunted by wolf mermaids.
All right, what are you guys going to do?
We should probably... Well, they can smell us, so there's no point in hiding.
Or how wide is the causeway?
10 feet wide.
All right, so I will have the... I'll ask the animated armor to take point.
Okay. It walks up in front of everybody else.
Magic casters, now to do your thing. You can't do crap.
Ergo gets his crossbow ready.
Okay.
Let's see what I got here. Oh, no, that's useless. I got nothing. Either of the magic people, do you have any plans for when you have time to set things up before combat or maybe?
I'm gonna set up a little map. I'll give you guys 5-minute break. We'll resume at 8:40 p.m.
Well, I need to get a drink.
Yeah. This would be the time.
Okay, so we are getting ready for a combat.
Well, not necessarily. You're getting ready for an encounter for sure, but it's something something I need to draw out in case it turns into a combat.
Okay. I will turn my armor of Aegis, and that's all.
Roland, if you got any more magic weapons, that'd be nice.
Okay, we have 5 minutes. Be right back.
All right, are we back?
I'm back.
Tim's back. I can hear Meridian sniffing.
Yeah.
Craig is back. Peck, you back? All right, everybody's here. Okay. So you guys see, you're crossing the, I've got you all onto my ghetto-ass combat map. And the little blue part is deployment zone, the light blue. So y'all can move however around you want.
Alina, whip or sword?
Sword.
All right, your sword is now a magic weapon.
Nice.
Okay.
Wait, which way is which? Oh, I can see which way is which now.
Yeah. I'm going to give animated armor control to you.
Me?
Yeah, you. Hang on. Let me figure out how to do that.
He's already got spells to worry about.
How long did we take in the tower?
Not an hour.
Okay.
All right.
I assume that the animated armor isn't going to be much more complex than running up and then walking up to things and punching them.
Beating the shit out of it. Yeah, basically sword. You just hit the multi-attack button when you touch the token and it should all go.
Nice.
Okay. All right. You see this pack of wolves kind of approach the other side of this causeway. What are you guys going to do?
I'll have Poe range out far above the wolves to see, because this clearly isn't natural.
Yes, that is definitely true. Elena's just going to swim away.
He's going to be looking for something terribly obvious, like maybe a wizard controlling these things.
I see. Okay, yeah. Give me a perception check for Poe. All right, Poe will tell you that there's no other... He doesn't see any other wolves or anything running in to reinforce from any distance.
So we don't have to... At least we don't have to worry about wolf reserves.
Right. Okay.
These wolves have no sense of tactical superiority.
It's true.
Got to take advantage of their numbers.
Okay, so... The one in front here, the one in red, he noisily transforms into a human with just like shredded clothes, or like a human wolf hybrid. He's got just shredded clothes, and he has a spear in one hand, and he's pretty like very muscular, very like fearsome looking. Just a lot of hair, a lot of fang, a lot of claw. Very intimidating.
These assholes again.
Yeah. And he says, "Hello, adventurers."
Hello.
Why do you come to Kazan's tower?
Oh, is that where this is? There's a tower. We were curious.
Yes. Were you just digging up old secrets or what?
Secrets?
Yes.
As far as we're aware.
Well, I am surprised you made it into this tower. We could not figure out how to open the door.
I just climbed up and went in the hole in the wall.
We didn't find anything of interest here. It's just a dump with a one suit of armor.
Ah, yes. A good suit of armor, though, yes?
Yeah.
That remains to be seen.
Why is there anything you can tell me about how Vistani get along with werewolves?
Give me a history check. Okay. Yeah, you have heard of werewolves like kidnapping children, typically not Vistani children, mostly Barovian children. That's the rumor that you know about these werewolves.
Okay, so no inherent animosity either way.
Right. Yeah. Other at least events. Not to the other fact events. That they're not like targeting Vistani in particular. They're just kind of kidnap children.
So it's all good then.
Well, I wouldn't say that. I know you were being facetious though. Okay.
Why do you ask, Wolfie?
Oh, no reason. I just your little group has cut quite a swath through Barovia. I understand you have laid low some of my compatriots.
We only cut when the path is unclear.
I understand this. This is very, very reasonable. I have maybe favor to ask you.
What kind of favor?
We have maybe answer for you.
Well, you see, here is the problem. Sorry, I've been rude. My name is Kyril. Kyril Stolnyanovic. And this is my pack.
How did you say the name?
Kyril. K-I-R-I-L.
Okay.
He says, I lead this pack. We make our home in these hills. This is our land. One of our kind has been captured by the Devil's Trad.
By who now?
The Devil's Trad.
Ah.
I think maybe you have met him.
Strad or your friend?
Strad.
Tall.
Yeah, we met him.
Bit of asshole.
He's not a nice man.
This is agreed. You see, one of my people have fallen ill with his strange rules in the regulations and is now being kept prisoner in Strad's dungeon.
Well, if we were able to find ourselves in Strahd's dungeon, I'm sure we could help. But
I'm sure we can strike some of you.
This would be lovely. His name is Emil. Emil Toranescu. And if you could find some way to release him from Strahd's dungeon, I'm sure he and I would also be very appreciative of your efforts.
Will you be willing to help us destroy Strahd?
If you release Emil from the dungeon, you will have our full support and we will rally to your banner.
And where is this dungeon? Do you know?
Underneath Castle Ravenloft. What say you?
Can we go into the dungeon without going into the castle?
I do not think this is possible.
Okay, I will turn around.
Turn around?
Yeah, to my companions.
Oh, yes, okay.
That's a net gain if not Strahd actually. It's a net gain if they still manage to kill Strahd. Or it's still a net gain if we manage to kill Strahd. I mean,
I meant net gain for them.
I mean,
no, even for them, you don't have to worry, not having to worry about Strahd. It's a big deal.
The more men is
whole population.
Never mind. I don't see any reason not to help them.
Yeah, but the problem is, we will probably go to his castle only when we are ready to destroy him, right?
Well, yeah, we're not gonna do it right now.
But their bargain is to first free that we free their men first, and then they will help us. But
we have to free them right now. I don't think. We can do it later once you've done the other things we need to do.
No, I didn't think like that. But we need to go inside the castle. But will we go inside the castle just for going there, not to destroy Strahd?
Okay. So, what's you guys' plan?
Oh, sure.
Eventually, okay. Sorry.
Yeah. Say.
Eventually, we are planning to go to Strahd's castle. When we do, we will attempt to free your friend. I'm sure we could do that. It's going to be a little bit of time before we can go there. We don't have our opening yet, but eventually.
Well, this is good news.
We will certainly go out there and try to do something about that situation.
And in the meantime, can we agree to leave one another alone as in our travels?
Of course. Right this way. And he steps to the side.
Insight.
Okay. Give me an insight check.
Okay, sure. Yes. I rolled 5.
Okay. What are you going to do with your animated armor? You going to command him forward?
Yeah, he's just going to be walking ahead of us.
Okay. Marcus will take the lead from you guys and, well, move forward. Okay. All right. Aragal, where are you going?
He is not, it seems.
Aragal will move up here.
Okay.
Well, it's gone now.
What happened to the map?
You guys get back. Just kidding.
He keeps a careful distance.
Okay. Aragal keeps a careful distance. When you guys get kind of in the midst of them, they say, Kyrol says, "You lot will not last in Barovia very long at all. In fact, I think this will be your last waking breaths. Now!" And as he does, some of the other werewolves turn into like a hybrid form and they move to attack. So go ahead and roll initiatives.
God damn this, my low insight.
How do I roll the armor's initiative, or does it just share mine?
I'll roll it for you. I think basically you just click on the...
Woohoo!
Oh, I just have these little things. Here we go. He's at a 0, I think. Right? Yeah.
Nailed it.
Okay.
I assume that's the werewolf's initiative.
What?
That 5.
No, it's the animated armor. I have them selected. Roll them for you. Okay, and then the werewolf. Okay.
I sure hope they don't all go on the same initiative, because then they'll kill us all.
Can you add me to the initiative and let me keep my 23?
Sure. I should probably add Roland, too.
And Marcus.
That's what I meant. Roland. Oops. Why do I keep thinking you guys are the same person? All right, here we go. Marcus, character sheet. Initiative. Do you have to select your person when you're doing it? Yeah. Okay. Oh, he's at a minus one. Okay. I think we're all in. Okay, Aragal, you are the first to act. You see these creatures transforming into hybrids and baring their teeth and obviously getting ready to attack.
Okay, so he had his crossbow in hand.
He did.
All right, so he's going to use his assassinate.
Okay.
Let's see. So he has advantage. All right. So here's his roll. And he's going to shoot at... This is the leader, right?
Yeah, the red one.
Oh, yeah. All right. He's going to start shooting.
Okay.
Okay, 19.
A 19's a hit.
Okay, so let's see. So he's going to use his sneak attack. With assassinate, it's a crit, so sneak attack, he can roll twice, yes?
Yes.
Woo!
Okay, it's a lot of damage. Okay. Question I have for you, that the crossbow is probably not silvered, yes? The bolts?
I would guess not, no.
All right, but at the very least, he's going to take 24 poison damage.
Oh, I'm not done yet.
Okay.
Okay, so here is...
So you rolled twice for the weapon and poison damage too, right?
I don't think you rolled twice for the poison damage.
You would not, but you would roll twice for the weapon damage.
You would roll twice for the weapon and the sneak attack damage, yeah.
Okay, so 14 piercing from the hit.
Yeah.
37 from the sneak attack and 28 poison.
28 poison or 24 poison? Oh, you have it there. 28, yeah.
Oh, why is it?
I don't know. It's fine. 28's fine.
28 was the roll. 24.
Oh, 24 is average. Okay, so 28 poison.
Got it. Okay.
14 if he makes a save.
Okay, he duffed his save, so he takes 28 poison damage.
So what, is he completely immune to everything else?
Yeah.
Yep.
Oh, jeez. Oh, no.
Oh, no. No. All right, Roland, your turn.
Wait. Ergo's moving.
Okay, you can move.
Calm down.
Let's see. He's going to move 30 feet, so he's going to move 30.
Well, unless you want to maintain concentration on my magic weapon the entire time, Margaret, Roland. I literally can't do anything unless someone gives me the magic sword.
So, The wolves that look like this are the ones that are in hybrid form, and the wolves that look like that just look like regular wolves. for what it's worth.
Look like regular wolves or are regular wolves?
Look like regular wolves.
Great.
Okay, Roland, what's the plan?
I'm going to place a fireball right here. So it will hit these 7 wolves / werewolves and sculpt
it around those.
Yes, so that yeah. It just curves around.
Okay, roll damage.
Man, that was a shit ton of damage just wasted.
It really was. Okay.
Like 79 points of damage, and like more than 2/3 of that was wasted.
Yep. Well, that's them's the breaks. Okay, and then it's gonna be dex saves at 15. Okay, so I'm gonna go from left to right. So, far left, he fails, and the bot. Oh, they all duffed it. So it's 32 points of damage for each one. Man. Well done, Roland.
All right. And so, I'll say, I'm not trying to tell you how to live your lives or anything, but you might want to rethink your current course of action. And I'll start moving back.
Okay.
Probably isn't going to be enough, but...
Did that go?
Sorry?
It didn't play the sound. God damn it. All right. Anyway, so you light up those 3 wolves, just like turn into ash, and then the werewolves around them are jarred by the impact of the fire, but they still stand. Okay, Elena, your turn.
Marcus, I implore you, please allow me to use your magical sword, so we can gather alive.
He says, I don't know what you're talking about. If anyone's going to use it, I will.
You just said you don't know what I'm talking about. Oh my god. Okay. Roland, anyone, but anybody please talk sense to Marcus.
I mean, Roland.
To you until it's his turn, anyway.
Didn't Roland imbue your sword with magic?
Yes, but as soon as concentration is gone, I will be utterly useless in this fight. Well, unlike the paladin who has magic spells.
Marcus is also doesn't have any magic items.
I'm sure that there are several enemies here that don't require silvered weapons to damage. Like the regular looking.
Yeah, if only your DM would give you a hint about that. Oh, wait.
All right. Well, I really don't. I'm out of game. Don't understand the opposition to me using the weapon, but it's fine. I'll just attack this wolf.
Stop whining.
I keep saying, man, it's in character. We don't want this thing getting around.
Haven't we already used it? Like,
no.
Before?
No, we haven't.
They really haven't.
We have never used it anywhere else.
It's been I'm very impressed.
We used it on the hilltop against those zombies.
I know for a fact we didn't
even wake the persona, right? We don't know anything about it. Oh god, yeah.
Alright, go ahead, make your attacks.
I'm just not even gonna.
Yep, those are both going to hit.
Yeah, it's going to be 11, 12, 9.
Okay,
so
you whip
20,
your... Yep.
32.
Yep, you whip your rapier down and pin the wolf's head to the ground.
I'm good. He's dead.
Can we assume that they're just regular wolves?
That one seems
right
like it was a normal wolf, yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
Here, 1, 2, 4, 5, 6. I'm gonna dash. No, I can't. Okay.
Okay. going to attack Elena.
No.
14 is not going to do it. Okay.
No. Not even close. I didn't take a level in fighter, so I get hit by 14s.
How far do these things move? 40, I think. Yeah.
Yeah, wolves move 40.
Yeah. He will dash right there.
Ooh. Okay.
All right.
So it just hangs out there?
Yeah, he can't attack.
Where was it at?
Over here. A double move. 80 feet gets you pretty far.
Mm-hmm. That's unfortunate.
All right, so first one's going to attack. This is on Audrey. Oh, two crits.
Right, yeah.
Yeah, so it's giving me 9 points of piercing damage, and you need to give me a strength saving throw or be knocked prone.
Okay,
just
told you guys to fall back.
She hasn't acted on her turn
yet. I know, it's in character.
Okay, so it was... How much? 9.
9 points of piercing, yeah. Alright, and then...
Okay, just...
Yeah, just give me a strength saving throw when you can. And then the other two are going to attack Marcus, who is a 16.
Okay. I succeed.
You succeed. Whoa. Good work.
Audrey hulks out.
One of them bites Marcus for 10 points.
I'm in luck because I hit my armor on.
And he needs to give me a strength save, which he makes successfully. Okay, is that all the remaining wolves? Yeah. Another one just took a double move. Okay, Audrey, you're up.
Good. Let's see. This side or this side? I will choose this side. I will cast Hypnotic Pattern.
I fucking hate that spell.
Here, okay. So it affects like this.
It's 20-foot radius sphere?
30-foot radius cube. So the...
30-foot radius cube.
Yeah, these three and this wolf.
Cubes don't have radiuses.
This is true.
Actually, these three here and this wolf. What is that?
Is that that's a 30-foot radius cube?
No, it's
a 30-foot cube. A 30-foot cube is 6 squares on each side of it. So.
No. Yeah.
Like that.
Yeah, it's but like
that. It's in a square.
So it's like this.
Okay, there it is.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I already calculated. Yeah, it's
okay.
No, yeah. It's instantaneous. Is that they just need to.
No, we got it. We got it. We got it. Next to that. Yeah. Okay. So it's going to be this guy and then his four buddies and then this wolf, right? And what's the DC on that?
All and so this all of them.
Here. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Just say 15.
DC 15. Okay. And that's a wisdom save, yes?
Yes.
Okay, I'm going from left to right on the werewolves. So, wisdom, far left. He duffs it. Next one.
Yeah.
Nope. Next one, he makes it. No. And the leader. Oh, that's a big miss.
And the wolf.
Who made it? The third one in a row. Okay. Okay, and then the wolf, wisdom, although the wolves have better wisdom than the werewolves, that's weird. Okay, yeah, the wolf makes it. Okay, so you put three of them in a trance. They stop what they're doing and kind of look towards your hypnotic pattern. Do you want to move?
Well, can't really. No, I will.
Okay, you're good there. All right. Marcus will try to slay these two wolves next to him. He's got two attacks, right? Yeah, he should. He'll get out his glaive and cut these bitches up. Oh my god, it's so cute, guys. He's married to Brittany Nightmore. That's the name of his wife. Oh my god, that's so cute. Oh my god.
Very lore friendly name, that.
Yeah. Okay. So his first attack hits one of the wolves, and 11 points of damage is enough to cut its head off, and he takes another attack. Hiya! 12 is going to miss, unfortunately. But he manages to kill one of the wolves. Animated armor.
All right, he is going to take a swing at this wolf in front, next to him.
This one?
Yes.
Okay.
That is not great.
21 hits for 6 points of damage.
All right, so it is going to... How much movement does it have?
It's a great question. 25 feet, which is an obnoxious number.
All right, so you'll start moving back towards me. 5, 10.
He has multi-attack.
Yeah, the werewolf will get two. You can't multi-attack on attack of opportunity, right? It's just one attack.
Just one attack.
How the hell is a wolf going to do to a suit of armor?
It's going to hit him with a spear. Hiya! 19 will hit.
Does that hit?
Wait, actually, does it? Yeah, their AC is 18. It's 18. So he does 8 points of damage.
So how phased does he seem?
He's got 33 hit points, I'll just tell you right now.
All right, I can see that.
Yeah.
Good lord. All right. He's going to keep moving.
Sure.
And praying that he doesn't get bowled over by the wolf.
All right, the wolf's going to attack. 19 will hit for 8 more points of damage. Give me a saving throw. His strength is +2.
No sweat.
Okay. Yep.
Wait, how much movement was that? 5, 10, 15, 20.
It's just 5 squares.
25.
That's fine. Yep. That's good, though. You cut off the... Okay. Werewolves. All right, so these two are... hypnotized. This one is going to go here and try to attack the little girl. One bite on little girl. 19 hit ya?
Yeah.
Alright. 3 piercing. And all right, so you feel a little funny. You feel a little strange.
Oh boy.
From now on, I'm going to roll those constitution saves. I don't want you guys knowing who hasn't, who doesn't. But that's fine for this one.
I don't know yet.
No, you wouldn't know.
Yeah. Wait. How many damage? 3 piercing.
3 points of piercing damage. That's it. And then he gets his spear attack on you.
Oh, God.
That's a miss. Okay. What?
Wait. Nothing better than Constitution. Concentration.
Oh, yeah, you need to give me a concentration check at 10. Yeah, you're fine.
Yeah.
Oh, snap.
I succeed.
Oh, you got it.
Ideal.
One of these is going to attack Audrey with a bite. That's a miss and a spear. 11. I can't imagine Whoa. That hits you. Yes, Audrey?
No.
No. Okay, and then Marcus as well. So there's a bite and a spear. That's a no. He's a 16. Okay, so that's those guys. This guy will move here. I guess I'll take a double move there. Okay. Do I get another save against wisdom on the other three that are entranced?
No.
No?
I don't think so.
No, no.
Yeah, it's charm for the duration.
Just,
yeah.
Just
oh my god.
While I'm keeping my concentration.
That's so good.
So that's another 9 rounds to go.
Yeah. Oh, but they can use their action to wake him up. Okay. Noted. All right. Aragol.
Okay. Aragol. Oh, you're right.
Move up. Okay. So he's going to take his left index finger, stick it in his mouth, and pull it out, covered with saliva, and then pull at the lower lid of his left eye and look at the leader.
No,
yes, I love this.
And say, this is for breaking your deal, you defiler of children and pederast.
Okay, what curse are you going to bestow upon him?
I am going to throw up the vulnerability to piercing curse.
Okay. Yeah. Alright, so it's a DC 8 plus your proficiency bonus plus your charisma modifier. So what's the...
Yeah. 11. It's terrible.
Okay, but their wisdom is 0, so it's actually got a pretty good chance of going through.
50-50. Yes! Yes!
Okay, he has a vulnerability to piercing damage.
Which would supersede the resistance.
I'm going to say it does, because that's way cool.
Nice. Does that wake him up?
It wouldn't, but
I don't think
it would.
It wouldn't, yeah, but attacking it will, exactly.
He has to take damage to wake up.
Right.